Dear viewers, welcome to Amsterdam, welcome to the University of Amsterdam, and welcome to the Bachelor's Program in European Studies. Thank you for joining us today here at this webinar. The purpose of this webinar is to give you an inside look at our teaching program in European Studies, and we would like to provide you with all the necessary information about the program. My name is P.W. Zuidhoff. I'm the program director of this program, and I'm also an associate professor in European political economy, which means that I teach courses in European economics. I've asked two of our current students to join us today and to give you a better perspective on what it is like to be a student in our program. And perhaps I could ask you to quickly introduce yourself, Mercy.
My name is Mercy Arndt. I'm German-American, and I'm a third-year European Studies student with a major in East European Studies.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, my name is Ruben Vilchengorgi. I'm in the second year of European Studies. I'm majoring in European Economics, and I'm from Luxembourg.
All right, welcome. Thank you for joining us also today. Okay, let's get started. I want to tell you a bit more about our program. And I'll introduce the program, and every now and then I will ask the students to comment a little bit on what their experience is in the program. So, welcome to European Studies. Actually, our program is offered in two languages. We have an English language, BA, that's why we're actually speaking English today, which we have started about 5 years ago, and which has an enrollment between 125 and 175 students every year. And our students, as you can see from the students represented here, come from all over Europe and beyond. We're also actually already for quite a long time have offered a program in Dutch, which is called Europese Studies, a Dutch language BA. That program has an enrollment of about 50 to 70 students. Since this is an online webinar, you don't have the opportunity to see the buildings, the lovely buildings where we actually teach. You do know what Amsterdam looks like. But here on the slide, we give you a little bit of an overview of what our buildings look like, because they're actually very pretty. The image in the bottom on the right is where most of our faculty have their offices, where some of our classes are. And you often have classes in the larger auditorium, of which I also provided a picture here. Actually, the Dutch and English language students often sit together in these large lecture rooms. All right. In European Studies, often when you are considering a study program, you sometimes have to explain what European Studies is about. I guess you experience that too. You know, if you opt for dentistry, everybody around you knows what the program is about. But European Studies, often you have to explain this a little bit. So let me introduce European Studies. And as I said, I teach mostly courses on economics, so every now and then I read The Economist, an English-based magazine. And when I was leafing through the pile of magazines next to my bed, I encountered all sorts of interesting images that told us something about Europe. For instance, here, an image, "Who can save Italy?" Or this one, "Maybe the Nordic countries can be the next supermodel." Doesn't look like a supermodel to me, but... And here, "America turns European." Here we see Barack Obama. I don't know what he is dressed up about like, but "America turns European." Or this one, still very active at the moment. "Goodbye Europe. What would happen if Britain left the EU?" Well, we are still wondering what will happen when Britain will leave the EU. Or this one, "Spain is obviously in pain." Or this one, "Angela Merkel, Bundeskanzler of Germany, is reading a big, red, fat book titled How to Break Up the Euro." That was at the time of the Eurozone crisis. So what do these images tell us about Europe? Or this one is also funny, "By Big Fat Greek Divorce," also at the time of the Eurozone crisis, where we see Merkel with Tsipras of Greece standing at the abyss, basically. May I ask you, what do you see? Here, Europe's Achilles heel. This is about Greece, obviously. What do you see in these images? Mercy, you're a third-year student. what do you notice when you look at these pictures?
Well, I see a lot of stereotypes about Europe and about the different nationalities of Europe.
Could you give me an example of a stereotype that you saw?
Definitely the Nordic supermodel stereotype, and also the French mime.
Uh-huh.
The idea that all French people wear berets and carry around baguettes.
Indeed. A very good example of a stereotype.
Yeah.
And Ruben, what did you see in the pictures?
Also, as Mercy said, stereotypes, but what I also see in the pictures was they talked about the different crises in Europe. For example, on the book which Merkel holds is How to Break Up the Euro, which was, I think, related to the Euro crisis, the same as Italy, also related to the Euro crisis, but also like stereotypes. For example, on the picture with Obama, the man next to him, I don't know the name now, but who was standing in Lederhosen, which is then a Bavarian and German stereotype. So, as Mercy said, like, I see the stereotypes, also the big politicians of every country, like Merkel, but also Tsipras and so on.
Yeah, and so Mercy, what are these stereotypes actually used for in these images?
Well, they're used, it seems, to sort of pit different countries against each other and to really show the tensions within Europe and internationally regarding Europe.
Yeah, so in order to look at Europe, we use stereotypes, and actually most of the pictures are quite critical, I think. The Economist is a very critical, usually, of European integration. Mm-hmm. So they reflect on questions, and as you said, indeed, also a lot of crisis that the European Union is facing a lot of times. And you see that reflected also in these pictures. Here's the last one. Looks like a Renaissance painting, and maybe for the viewers it's not very clear to see, but you see a lot of right-wing populist leaders, Marine Le Pen, Geert Wilders from the Netherlands, Farage on the way that Europe goes to the pole. But you also see that it looks like an old-fashioned painting, but it's also commenting on contemporary questions in Europe. And I think that is really characteristic of the program in European Studies here at the University of Amsterdam. What do we study in this program? We obviously study contemporary questions of political, economic, or legal issues that have to do with European integration. We saw some of these crises, as you were referring to, and we saw some of these political tensions. But we do that by studying these contemporary political questions very much against the background of the cultural background. So in order to understand what's going on in Europe, and you pointed it out, we draw on all sorts of cultural references. And we had the Greek vase, that is obviously a reference to Greeks' role in antiquity. Some of them are more stereotypical, but here we also use cultural and historical sort of background. So I think that's really a key feature of our program. We study contemporary issues, but we try to understand these contemporary issues by looking at their diverse and cultural and historical background. Sometimes I use this image to explain what our program is about. It basically has two pillars. Obviously, we study in our program a lot of integration questions. For instance, if you are in the European economics major, then you look mostly at the European Union. That's about politics, you could say. That is about the hardware of Europe at this moment. We see them always in interaction with what you could say is the software, is more questions about identity. Who are we? And in order to understand who we are, where we come from, we need to look at history and we need to look at culture. And so here's a few images, some of them also stereotypical cultural references. And in order to understand, I think, Europe today, and that's what we do in our program, we try to look at both of these pillars in their interaction. That's why the two arrows between identity and integration. Okay. What sort of students are we looking for in our program? Well, obviously, we're looking for students and students that have a broad interest in Europe. I mean, there's no point studying European studies if you're not interested in Europe. And obviously, you're interested in the history and culture of Europe. And that's one of the pillars of our program. And we're looking for students that are at the same time interested in the politics, the economics, the legal aspects of European integration. I think another feature of our program that didn't come out yet is that we also focus on the various regions in Europe. And we have a very strong group that is working on Eastern Europe, but also on the southern parts of Europe and its neighborhoods. And you're in the major in East European studies. We're looking at students that have obviously a very international outlook. It can be Dutch students, also in the Dutch language. We have an international outlook, but we have a lot of international students that are also interested in international affairs. we offer about 15 foreign languages that you can study. So we work on your international outlook. And we must say a lot of our faculty is actually has an international background, and a lot of our students obviously have an international background. And I think a third feature of our program is that it's actually a very flexible program. There's a lot of options to tailor your own study program, and which will become clear when we talk a bit more about the elements that you chose. Mercy, what was the reason for you to pick this program? Is it among the three that I mentioned here?
Definitely the international sort of aspect of it. When I was researching programs, I knew I wanted somewhere in Europe, and the Netherlands had great English language programs. And then European studies, when I really decided that it was my first choice, it was after looking at the list of faculty from the program and seeing just how international the teaching staff would be. And I grew up going to international schools, so I knew that that was a really important, you know, aspect of an education.
Right. For you?
For me too. but also this broad aspect of European studies with analyzing history, but also cultures, but also as well as politics, economics and law was really a tempting thing for me.
Yeah.
That it really gave me a broad outlook on everything contemporary to Europe, which was really interesting for me, and that was the main reason to study this study program.
Did you maybe consider picking an economics program, since you now specialize in economics?
Yes, I was considering it, but then on the other side, I want something where I see more than right. just the economics part, but also like a really broad view on everything, and that's what European studies gave me.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. So this is sort of outlining a bit in general what sort of students we're looking for. Okay, just to give you another flavor of what we do at European Studies and in our program, I've designed a little quiz. And you are going to be my contestant in the quiz. There's no prizes in this quiz. But the question is, what European issue is depicted in the following pictures? Any idea who this is? Who this is? You can say no.
Yeah.
You do?
It's Jussi Halla-aho.
Okay.
And he's a Finnish populist politician.
Okay. Any idea who this is?
I don't know.
Spanish.
Spanish.
Left-wing populist.
I think his name is Pablo Iglesias, yeah. And he is indeed from a Spanish populist party. any idea who these two dudes are?
Yes.
If I may say this so disrespectfully.
on the right side, you have Jörg Meuthen.
Yeah.
And on the left side, you have Alexander Gauland. And both are right-wing populist politicians from Germany, from the AfD.
Yeah, Alternative für Deutschland. I think we are already sort of guessing. Who's this?
Tsipras.
Tsipras, yes. From Greece. Oh, who's this?
Orbán.
Orbán, Hungary. Mm-hmm. So what is the European issue depicted here?
Populism in Europe.
Yeah, yeah. And yeah. The rise of populism. Mm-hmm. And Marine Le Pen in France, Farage in the UK. So obviously a very European sort of situation. We see the rise of populism. It's not just in one country, but it happens all over Europe. By the way, they're sort of mapped out. This is our Dutch version of the populism, Thierry Baudet. So obviously, what is the European issue? We see a rise of populism in Europe. These are the various political parties that they're affiliated with. And that obviously leads to all sorts of European questions that we could ask about the rise of populism. If we would study the rise of populism, first question is obviously, what is populism? Well, some of the definitions define populism as the political movements that try to mobilize the will of the people against some kind of elites. They're always very critical of elites, Europeans. The Brussels is one of these elites that they often sort of mobilize again, but also local elites. Another question that we could ask ourselves in our program is, why is this suddenly on the rise in Europe? It's actually a very complicated question to ask. So why does it come up in various places in Europe? Are there any European connections, perhaps, between these various parties? Do they have a secret conference where they go to and perhaps exchange ideas, or other types of connections? In the rise of populism, another sort of question that we may ask in our program is, what is the role of nationalism? we spend a lot of time on studying nationalism in Europe. So what is the relation between nationalism? And often populist parties, they drive and they thrive on nationalist ideas. Another question we could ask is, why are so many of these parties indeed Eurosceptic? So they are against local elites, but they often also are against the Brussels elite. What is the role of history and culture in this development? And or is there any role in politics or economics or law in the development of these parties? The various parties have a somewhat difficult relationship with the law in a number of countries. And are there perhaps economic explanations that we could ask that in the economics major? And another question that you could ask in our program, how is populism different in the various areas in Europe? And actually the various populists, if you may call them as such, were also very different. Did you take any courses where you discussed populism in your program, Mercy?
Not explicitly. But certainly it comes up because nationalism is such an integral part of European history and East European history. So talking about the relationship between Russia and the EU, and I mean, populism is always part of the discussion there.
Okay, yeah. Elribe, did you encounter it?
Yes. I don't want to spoil now, but there are different courses in the first year where you talk about, for example, the national idea, what nationalism is exactly, but also about European integration, where from now and then there are texts about populism and where we also speak about populism.
Right. And so populism is really the rise of European populism, and populism in Europe is obviously a topic that is really, I think, typical for a program in European studies. We need to look at the everyday politics, the politics of it, but we also need to understand it in its cultural and historical backgrounds, the two pillars of European studies in Amsterdam. Okay, let's move a little bit closer. You already started talking about this. Let's move a little bit closer in what you would actually study if you decide to pick the program in European Studies. I've mapped out only the first year of our program to show you and to give you a bit of a sense, would you opt for the program in European Studies, what it would be like in your first year, what courses you would take. So if you look at the schedule, I perhaps have to explain a little bit what is being depicted here. At the University of Amsterdam, we break the year into semesters. These are the fat black lines in the drawing. And the semester starts in the 1st of September and ends on the 1st of February. And then the semesters we divide up in three blocks. The first two blocks are somewhat longer blocks of 8 weeks, and then we usually have an intensive block, which is after Christmas, which is right in January, of only 4 weeks. And then we repeat the same model in the second semester. Here are some of the courses that you would take. So in the first year, you would start with a number of courses which I would call identity courses, courses that deal with history and culture. Especially your first block is really, we give you a sort of a foundation in the culture of Europe, questions of nationalism in the course called National Thought in Europe, and an history course, Turning Points in Modern European History, which is basically an overview of entire European history, but mostly post-World War II history of Europe. Another of those identity or history courses is the Other Europe. That's a course specifically devoted to East European studies and is mostly dealing with the history of Eastern Europe, the Other Europe, in our program. And also in the second semester, we have one identity course, which is called European Literary History. This course is not so much historical as a history course, but looks at literary works and tries to read literary works, works of literature, and also increasingly films and perhaps even Netflix series, to see how Europe and the idea of Europe and how national ideas and national stereotypes are being expressed in these literary works. So you will take at least four courses with a strong history and culture basis. You will also take two courses, and one of them is a slightly larger course, which are more from the integration side. In the European integration course, you will look at the history of European integration, the formation of the European Union. And in these courses, we study the history and especially also the political institutions and the politics of the European Union. In the second semester, you will get a second course devoted to European integration. It's a course that I actually teach in. And this course is devoted half to law and half to the legal aspects of European integration and half to the economic aspects of European integration. So besides culture and history, two courses, or actually 18 credits of courses, devoted to European integration questions. So that is the hardware of Europe. Another component in our first year, and that's sort of important to know, so we do culture and history, we do contemporary politics, is a third element in our program is the aspect of language acquisition. A third element in our program is indeed the is language acquisition. We require from all our students that study in the European integration program that they take up and that they study a foreign language, a language that they do not yet speak. You will start with that in your first year, and you will continue studying this foreign language in the second year. Here's a list of the languages that we offer at the University of Amsterdam. And the various some languages actually have also a few different levels. If you have already speak some German, you can go into a higher level German course or a higher level French course. But these are basically the courses that we have on offer in Amsterdam, courses to choose from. Mercy, you already spoke a lot of languages, I think, before you came here. Which language did you pick for as your language requirement?
I started with advanced German, so I took advantage of the different levels of German.
Okay, very good.
And I chose it because I am technically a German citizen, but never lived in Germany, and my German grammar was abominable. And so I decided it was time to improve it.
Improve your German.
Yeah.
Ruben, what language did you pick?
I took Dutch. I started with the beginner's course because I didn't speak Dutch before. And I thought it's a really interesting language for me, especially since I'm living in Amsterdam now, and then I could also speak the language of the residents.
So. Right, right, exactly. So you could help yourself to do that. Exactly. People have various reasons for why they pick a specific language. Maybe you want to do research in a certain area. If you want to do East European studies, you may want to study Russian. But also people usually follow their interests. And in your case, for instance, picking up on your German background is really useful. So students pick their own language in their program. Well, to continue the story about what we do in the first year, so we have identity courses, culture and history, we have political integration courses, European integration, for instance, language acquisition courses that we do. And a fourth element in our first year is all students obviously also need to learn some of the basics of doing academic research and academic writing. So we have actually two courses that are really specifically designed to research methods and to writing methods where you learn the basic academic skills. One of them is tied to the European integration course where you will write your first somewhat larger academic paper. And in the second semester, we have the first year seminar where you will really do a little a small research project, and that will result in a somewhat longer paper. So also academic skills will appear in the first year. Can I ask you, perhaps starting with you, Ruben, what was your favorite course from the first year?
I think my favorite course was the economic and legal integration course.
Oh, okay.
Because I myself am really interested in politics and about the European Union, and this gave me really a broad overview on how it all got together legally and also economic-wise.
Yeah. And for you, Mercy?
I really enjoyed National Thought in Europe.
Okay. Opening course.
Yeah. I think it gave a really good background to the rise of nationalism and just European history. And
could you give an example of what you read or studied in this course? If you still remember, it's 3 years ago.
Yeah, it's a while ago. We read lots of, you know, excerpted kind of texts from really big thinkers in national thought. And so it gave a really good just overview of how different stereotypes and ideas and imagery developed over the centuries.
Interesting. And in the economic and legal course, actually I'm the lecturer, so I do know what you do in the course, but is there a lot of complicated math or
not at all.
Graphs? No.
You have some graphs and like really small maths, but nothing really yeah. that hard, as for
example. A lot of students are always very nervous about economics because it has math. We don't bother too much with the math. We try to do economic thinking. But okay, it's rigorous, I think, economic thinking. Okay, so this is a sort of an overview of the first year. I think it's a mixed bag of various courses. Some courses you like a little bit better. Perhaps a course that you like the least, Mercy?
I'd say European literary history.
Okay.
Just because I came in with a bit of a bias already.
Okay.
I really like to read, but then any kind of analysis
okay.
on it always ruins it for me. But it was still a really, you know, again, we read lots of kind of seminal texts in European literary history, so it gave a nice...
Yeah, that's good for your background. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you, Ruben, what's your sort of...
My least favorite course was actually National Thought in Europe.
Oh, okay. So you're really totally different interest.
I don't know. I just preferred the other course. It's not that I didn't like it, but I think from 1 to 10, it's
okay.
my least favorite.
It's your least favorite course. Yeah. Okay, we all need least favorite courses. I think this also is interesting because it shows that, you know, our students are quite diverse. You do not necessarily need to like all the elements that are in the program. Some of them are more towards what you like than others. So I think, and actually, the first year, you have to take all the courses. They are required courses. Especially in the second and third year, you have options to also choose other elements in your program. All right, so I was already talking a little bit about what will you do in your second and third year. I don't want to go into all the courses that we have on offer, which is about 50 or 60 courses, but you will continue with your language acquisition. So the language that you picked in the first year, you will continue improving that language, reading, writing skills, a little bit of speaking skills you will work on. But I think the major part determining this, the second and third year of your program is your choice of a major. So we require from all students that they pick a major. We offer five different majors: a major on European culture, a major on European history, a major on East European studies, a major in European law, and a major in European economics, the one that you chose. There's five different flavors, and we see that the students sort of equally distribute themselves over the five different aspects. So if in the first year you really liked the European literary history course and national thought, you may want to continue in the European culture major. If you really were caught on with history, the students continue obviously in the European history major. Could you say a little bit about why you picked the major that you picked?
I came into this program knowing that it was the major I wanted. I applied from the Republic of Moldova after a volunteer year there. And I thought that the faculty was really, really excellent. And I loved the readings that we did in the first year and such. And it was totally the right decision. I love my major.
Okay, so you actually already knew a little bit in advance that you were going to pick this major.
Yeah.
Ruben, so how did you come to pick this major?
I think, first of all, it was out of interest because from all the majors, European economics was my most biggest interest, let's say like that. And I also, I loved economics. I had it a bit back in high school. And so I found that was the most interesting for me and also for my... for what I want to do later, it's also the best way.
Right. And we see that some students know already in advance and they really come to European studies in order to pick the European law major or the European economics major or the East European studies major. But we also see that some students discover actually other topics in the first year and they really are gripped by, for instance, East European studies or history when they pick on these topics. What do you want to do with your major? Do you have any ideas where you want to take this?
Well, my plan is to go back to the United States and to go to law school there.
Oh, okay.
And then work in international law. And so that's where European studies will come in. And specifically, I'm interested in things like human trafficking.
Okay,
And preventing that. So that's where East European studies comes in.
Yeah. And for you, Ruben, any ideas?
My plan is to later on specialize on international relations. So I thought that's the major could really contribute to this.
Could contribute to it, right. So in the second year, at the beginning of the second year, you pick your major. And that's a relatively big decision in your program, because it sort of determines the specialization that you pick. But we actually also require from all students that they pick a second specialization. Now, that's not a full major. It's actually only 12 credits of courses, but we require that students take a second major in one of the five. So that's basically your second flavor. I always see an ice cream scoop, a big scoop and a small scoop. So what is your second major specialization?
My second major is European law.
So European law. So mm-hmm. that makes sense in also where you want to move. Mm-hmm. And so just to show, two different flavors make one person and one study profile. For you, did you already pick your second major?
No, but I am normally going to pick European law.
So you also pick European law, so yes. Sorry, second. And so that's what we see, is that the students, so you first pick your language, secondly you pick your major, and then you pick your second major, and already in these three sort of options create very different profiles for different students. So that creates a very different type of program. In the third year, you actually have even more options to choose from. If you like, that there's an elective space of about 30 credits, which is half a study year, and students can then actually pick, for instance, a minor next to their major, or can decide to go for a semester to study abroad, or perhaps to do an internship, or just pick random courses on topics that you would be interested in. Now, here's, for instance, a list of minors that you can pick. Our own program offers a minor in European politics, so you could actually consider doing a major in European history and do a minor in European politics. But there's other programs in the University of Amsterdam, so you could also decide to place next to European studies, for instance, Mediterranean studies or Middle Eastern studies, if you really have a regional interest. We see students pick more on the languages that they picked, and other students, for instance, what you're talking about is also international relations, and there's many more options at the University of Amsterdam to pick from. Did you, any one of you, do a minor?
I at first considered doing a European law minor, but then there were some electives that I really wanted to take instead of those extra courses. So.
You?
Not yet.
Not yet. You're not there yet. Any ideas to go perhaps study abroad?
Yes, but I'm not doing it next year.
Okay, so you're considering planning that. That requires always a little bit of planning. We also see that a lot of international students, you are in a way already studying abroad. So you study abroad from studying abroad. That may be a little bit too much. But there's obviously also a lot of students that go to France or to Spain, for instance, also to improve their language skills. So we see students picking that too. Okay, I want to tell a few more things, a bit more technical things about our program. I think we have designed a program that helps students really study effectively and help succeed in the program. For instance, the courses, you only take two courses at the same time. That's the semester system, which really helps you only concentrate on two courses at the same time and two exams at the same time, instead of taking, for instance, five courses as you do at some other universities. We have a tutor system, so every incoming student is being assigned a tutor, which is a lecturer, a tutorial group lecturer, that can actually help you, because you have a lot of options to choose from, to pick your major, to help you assist with picking your language to do so. Another measure that we have in the program is called, which is a little bit more strict, is called the binding study advice, which is an awkward translation of a Dutch term called bindend studieadvies, which is a requirement that all students that start in the first year need to pass at least 48 credits from the total of 60 credits, which is basically, I always need to do the math right, 8 out of the 10 courses that are being offered in the first year. You need to pass 48 credits in order to be allowed to continue in the second year. So if you do not manage to pass the 48 credits, the 8 courses, you may not be able to continue into the second year. Obviously, if there's personal circumstances that prevent you from studying, you will get an exemption from this rule. Did you find this difficult, the binding study advice?
No.
You just passed. How many courses did you pass from the first year?
All of them.
All of them. Very good.
I also passed all of them, but I think also it's not that hard because you have tutors who help you a lot, and also as studying effectively, it, like how it's designed, it really helps you to pass it.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. Now, some students are a little bit worry sometimes a little bit, will I be able to pass the 48 credits? But on average, we see if you're just a regular student, if there's no sort of obstructions in your study path, you will manage with that. We also try to help our students, although it's perhaps a little bit early, to help them orient a little bit towards the labor market. So we have an interesting workshop called European Studies at Work. Yeah? Sometimes it's good to think about what can you do with the program. We try to offer international opportunities to our students. And we have also built a sort of structured program to help you graduate. And one of the hardest tasks, I think, in the program is actually to write your final BA thesis. Are you working on that already?
Yes.
You've started?
Yeah.
Yeah, and so we offer you a sort of a research seminar first to help you sort of build the research project for your BA thesis, and then you actually work on this. So we also help students really get through the program. Some more technical details. Prospective students are interested in how do I apply for this program and how will I be admitted. I want to refer you to the website because that's where always the latest information is being published on how to apply to the program. But you apply through a certain webpage, which is the Dutch University Admissions webpage, which is called StudiLink. You'll find links on the webpage. But that's where you apply. You would need to obviously supply a proof of your diploma. For Dutch students, this is a VWO diploma, this is a high school diploma of the highest level, or international equivalents. And a lot of these international equivalent diplomas are actually also printed on the website, so you can see whether your specific diploma would apply. Now, you would also need to submit a proof of English proficiency. For Dutch students, it means if you pass the high school English requirement, you can be admitted to the program. Some students need to show a proof from one of these international tests that are printed here. But on the whole, actually, that is I don't think that creates too much difficulties. What is important is that you abide by the application deadlines, and especially important is that students coming from a non-EU nationals, and it has to do mostly with visa requirements, you really need to apply before the 1st of April of every academic year. EU nationals, so, and it's not about your diploma, but it's about your nationality, all EU nationals can apply up until the 1st of May of every academic year, and EU nationals, and also, which obviously also includes Dutch nationals. Important dates to remember, please go online if you have more questions about this or contact the admissions office because they will be able to answer the more technical questions around your diploma or whether you can be admitted to the program. After you have applied and you have been admitted to the program, we have an event, which is actually an online event, which is called UvA Matching. The purpose of this event is that we want to give you one more checkup to figure out for yourself, mostly, whether European Studies is really the right program for you. So you will receive an invitation to participate in UvA Matching, which is an entirely online procedure. And during this procedure, you will actually be able to watch an online lecture, a little bit similar to what you see here. You will receive some readings, and we will ask you to do a small test on these readings. Once again, this is not an admissions test. We are not testing whether you are qualified to join the program. It's really to show you this is what it's like to study European Studies, and perhaps is this really what you're looking for. So, it is actually to determine also for yourself to see whether your expectations of the program match with the program. And if you think, I thought I was going to do dentistry, and now I have to study the history of Europe, maybe this is not the right program for you. I always make the joke about dentistry. Okay, this is really far ahead in time, but most students are actually already interested in thinking about what can you do with a BA program in European Studies. Now, most students, in my experience, continue after the BA program into a master's program. For instance, our own university is offering 3 master's programs in European Studies, which help you further specialize in the topics that you have worked on during your BA. But we also see that a lot of students branch out to all sorts of various other MA programs. Some stay here in Amsterdam, but you can obviously also go internationally. Mercy already said it a little bit, but what are your plans after the BA?
I'm a little bit of an exception because I'm going back to the United States to law school there, which doesn't require a bachelor in law.
Okay.
And then going into the legal profession and international law.
Right.
Yeah. But I know lots of my friends are going into master's degrees in literary analysis, international relations, both here in Amsterdam and back in Germany or UK or whatever.
Yeah. So, and we see this program, it's a very broad program. And so we also see that everybody builds their own profile. And depending, obviously, on the profile that you build during your BA, that determines quite a lot where you're moving. Do you already have any idea where you're moving?
Yes, I said I'm also planning on doing a master in international relations.
Yeah.
And also normally not in Amsterdam, but also abroad. But
yeah. Yeah, so sounds very interesting. I would love to do that myself one more time, another degree. Another question that we often get is, so what are the career prospects? Well, as I said, most students actually continue first into an MA and only then the real career, what sort of jobs you get, depends on that. Once again, our students have a very diverse profile, so obviously they also end up in very diverse professions. Some go into the legal professions. We see a lot of students ending up at various international organizations, governmental organizations, but also non-governmental organizations, going into business, working at cultural institutions. So basically media, basically all sorts of professions follow from what you do here. Unlike dentistry, it's not a specific profession that we train you for, but we try to you have a strong background, I think, contemporary questions, but also writing and research skills that actually open up a whole world of various professions. Okay, we are nearing the end of our presentation. I think I've been talking for quite a bit, and I've been talking a lot about what we do in our program. Let me end with asking you a few more questions. Unfortunately, the students sitting at the other side of the screen cannot ask their questions. So I will try to imagine perhaps some of the questions for you. Mercy, I'm not going to ask this question to you, but I'm going to ask to Ruben. This is you. You picked the English track,
yes.
Obviously not the Dutch track. But in the English track, was it hard for you to study in English?
In the beginning, it was a bit because I didn't come out of an English system, so I really had to get used to having everything in English. But I think also your teachers respect that, so it really got easy with the time, and now it's not hard at all anymore.
Yeah, okay. Did you have any language difficulties?
No, but I was the unofficial essay editor for a lot of my friends, so I got to see their progression, and several came in. They all came in with different levels, and several really struggled in the beginning. But by now, I mean, they're writing their thesis in English and having a great time with it.
Right.
So
yeah. And did the program live up to some of your expectations? And sort of what expectations were satisfied? And perhaps what surprised you when you got to the program? I'll start with Mercy.
My expectations were met. I came in and I thought it would be an interdisciplinary program, and I'd learn a lot and have really international classroom and all of those things above and beyond what I wanted. In terms of surprise, I think I had a pretty good sense of what I was getting myself into.
Yeah, so no awkward surprises, and also no positive surprises. Something that really struck you? That's really.
I guess the cultural aspect of the studies, because you look at a lot of history and culture that then affects modern day, economics and politics and such. And as I said before, I was a little bit biased against, analyzing some literary texts and things, but it really comes in handy. So I ended up really liking that aspect.
Yeah, but actually, I understood that you're now working as a student assistant for our professor in literary history.
Yes. So starting in my second year and continuing into this year, I'm a student assistant with Hugh Blairson, who's sort of a legend in the department.
Right.
And he works a lot on nationalism and, literary studies and such.
Yeah. So what do you do as a student assistant? Because that must have been a surprise for you to also have a small job. This happens very, very not too often that students find a job on campus. But so what do you do as part of this student assistant?
I work 8 hours a week on his Encyclopedia of Romantic Nationalism, which is an online encyclopedia. It's pretty cool, which charts the rise of nationalism in Europe. And so I've been writing some entries for the encyclopedia, and I do editing work and some research and bibliographic stuff.
So, okay, that must be a great experience.
It's great, and it's paid.
And it's paid, but that's even better. Yeah. Ruben, for you, sort of did meet expectations. Are there some things that surprised you?
My expectations were fully met. I think I was also quite, I knew what I'm getting into, but I was really surprised in my own interest how they developed. For example, I was, really surprised that the European literary course really was a course that appealed for me, which I didn't expect in the beginning. So it's also super nice to have different languages and also different courses. Then you just see where your interests are without knowing it before.
Yeah. And Mercy, could you say something about what was the most important thing that you learned in the program? Maybe for yourself.
That's tricky.
We're going towards the end. And
Well, I think I learned, and I think a lot of my classmates learned, how fun it is to do original research. Because in the first year, it's a lot about building up your knowledge, and you certainly start writing and things. But in the second and third years, in your major, you know, courses and major electives, you start getting the chance to do your own research and choose your own topic and really get interested in what you're researching, and that's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And
could you give an example of something that you were working on?
Yeah. In my second year, one of my favorite courses was a course on post-conflict transitional justice in Yugoslavia, and it was taught by a woman, Nana Trump, who herself worked for the tribunal for Yugoslavia in Hague, and she was, of course, a great resource, and we got to choose our own topics for a final essay at the end, and I got to look at war memorials in Kosovo, and got to look into the history and development of those memorials, specifically for survivors of wartime rape.
Right.
So that was up my alley, and it was a great experience.
Yeah. Ruben, for you, what did you learn the most?
Writing skills?
I
come out of an educational system where you don't write such essays.
Okay.
And then, like, having this original research doing this is something that I didn't know before and that I really got to know in European studies, and that's really important, I think.
Yeah. And we're going to close with the last question. So if you have to give advice to the prospective students, what would you, should they go about making the decision whether or not to go to this program or to go to another program? What is the most important piece of advice that you would want to give them?
Well, I guess in the same vein of research, original research, I would definitely go on to the program website of every program that you're interested in and look at the course catalog.
Right.
And really read about the courses that you'll be taking in all 3 years of the program, because if you read the course description and you don't get excited, then don't apply. But if you do get excited, definitely do apply.
Yeah, I think that's a good piece of advice.
Also, if you have a really broad interest in different topics which are related to Europe, this is the perfect program,
okay,
in my opinion.
In your opinion. All right. I think we'll leave it at this. I'll end by showing you a slide with some more information of where you can get more information. This is obviously one. This webinar is obviously one way that you can get more information on what we do. If you have a chance to come to Amsterdam and to visit the university, you could, for instance, join a program which is called Student for a Day. You will be following and be accompanied by one of our students that visit some classes. We also have another sort of small lectures that are really specifically designed for incoming students that you can have a sort of an afternoon to really experience what it's like to be a student here. There's obviously more resources on the web to look us up. really don't hesitate to contact either the admissions office or somebody from us. I would say me, not you, but I don't want you to be overburdened with student questions. But also through the web pages, there's contact information. You can actually chat with students. So really make use of these opportunities to figure out whether this is the program that you would like to join. I will just close this webinar. Thank you for giving more information to the students. I think it's useful to hear what you have to say. Thank you to all the viewers. Thank you for joining us here today. We look forward to welcome you here in Amsterdam. I'm just reminding you of the environment here. And let me close to say good night and goodbye.